Great. Thanks, Ted. Well, I want to jump right in with a question responding to something that I think both you and Tim spoke to. You both addressed the need to just build more affordable housing. And there are some people, including, I think, members of the Los Angeles City Council, who have said, we just need to build more housing, that will then take care of the need for low-income and workforce housing. But let me throw this question to the panel. If we just build more housing, will we take care of the housing need at all levels?
Well, I think as at least in terms of Pasadena, that doesn't appear to be the case, so I'll just leave it at that.
And I would just say no.
No, I would agree with the panelists. I don't think that it's a one-sided solution. You know, it's a multiple-pronged solution. We need to create more housing across all income sectors. Does that mean that we're going to be able to create the very low-income housing that we need just by market factors? Probably not. You know, we do need to have a long-term sustainable funding source to provide subsidies for that type of housing. There's no doubt about it.
But I think as we've seen soft subsidy disappearing, and especially here in California, the redevelopment agency funds disappearing, we see many cities turning their limited resources to caring for the most needy and providing probably fewer units that are higher cost for a needier population. And I think Sean said it, you know, nobody's going to take care of these people that are kind of at the lowest rung. But when you think about leveraging private resources, banks in particular, I think about in California how we don't access all of our 4% tax exempt capacity, and how if you, and I'm just playing devil's advocate, if you took some of those resources and put them towards building more 50 and 60% of AMI housing, you would be creating a lot more units. And I guess that's where you're creating a trade-off. Who do you care for? Do you care for the neediest, or do you create a lot of more units for 50, 60% of AMI, you know, working low-income folks who are trying to get ahead?
I would add that, you know, I think you've heard from all of the speakers today that there's just a production gap overall at all income levels. And if you're building at a market rate level, you're building both a housing type and housing product that's not going to be affordable. So what you have left, and it's this disparity again, is the existing housing stock that's going to meet the need of the lower income folks. And I think one of the things that Sean pointed out in his presentation is that the overcrowding issue, that housing stock is not really going to be able to accommodate the household size and needs of the families at the lower income. So not you're just creating greater disparity in the quality housing, the affordability housing, and how people live. So the answer is no.
Okay, so we have a subsidy gap. We heard Alice say that subsidy is key. Folks in the room may be aware that the City of Los Angeles commissioned a study that looks at the nexus between development in the city and the increased need for affordable housing. I was in a meeting yesterday with Olson Lee, who's the director of the San Francisco Housing Department, where I heard about the fee structure that's been put in place associated with new development in San Francisco to support affordable housing development. So how about it? Creating a nexus fee tied to development, is this a good way to go for funding affordable housing?
I'll take a shot at that. We in Boston implemented a similar policy quite a while ago, 20 plus years ago, and it was a response to development boom going on in the city, in the office market, in the healthcare market, and their impact fees. It basically came down to about $3 on a present value basis on developments that cost $400 to $500 a square foot to build, and generated millions of dollars that were then able to be used to subsidize and build affordable rental housing within the city, where this boom was bringing in workers, people, high-income workers into the city, which was having a negative impact on the affordable market, the affordable housing market in the city. And we were able to implement that at a de minimis cost in the overall scheme of things to the construction cost of the project. So I endorse that.
Well, and I, I think what we're seeing in higher-end markets where there is a 20% inclusionary requirement, we are seeing some creativity around 80-20 structuring and creating 80-20 projects when you have the 80% market at a pretty high rent, and you can attract some private equity as well as having your tax credits and tax-exempt financing. Some of those deals are penciling without any public subsidy, and we're seeing similar projects in higher end areas just around strictly inclusionary. We have a large master developer and a smaller inclusionary phase being done by an affordable housing developer using tax-exempt bonds without any public subsidy needed other than the tax-exempt bonds and the 4% low-income housing tax credits. So when we're talking about limited subsidy, you know, we're seeing some of those work. It does depend on the market, and it depends on a pretty high level of market rate rents.
So I'll start by saying that finding a dedicated or permanent source to subsidize affordable housing, it's not one solution. I think we have to look at multiple ways in order to address the challenge. The study by the LA Economic Roundtable did make that connection between the development of everything from residential to office to industrial, that it has an impact on the local population growth, which impacts housing and the need to produce housing. So there's definitely the nexus between that. The study also talked about how you could tier an impact fee or take consideration for geographically where the development is located. But I think that the nexus is not a question. There's clearly the nexus that exists. But so the question becomes, is it the right source to support the production of affordable housing? And is there enough political will and support from different advocacy groups to utilize it as that source? But the nexus is definitely there.
So I guess it's left to me, representing the builders and developers that would pay the fee, to address the question. So, you know, speaking on behalf of the people that would actually pay the fee, is that, you know, they don't mind paying their fair share, but what happens is that they get looked at to pay the full burden. So I think we need to really look at the bigger picture and the full-blown multiple layers of solutions to the problem. And if we do that and it turns out that that is one particular part of it that leads to a solution, and we show that it's the fair share contribution, then there may not be a problem with that, and we may not oppose it. But what happens is that we aren't looking at all the other solutions. It's looked at as, well, let's just make the new development pay for it. And then what happens is that we drive up the cost of all the market rate. So, you know, we need to be careful about how we address this problem. And I think we need to take a broader-based approach on how we look at it. You know, you saw the different cost numbers that I put up earlier. And we need to look at how do we drive those costs down. You know, there's a lot of other things we need to be looking at besides just, you know, taking the easy approach of, well, let's just make new development pay for it. So my answer to that is it's possible that that's a solution, but we're not there yet to be able to say if that's the right solution or what dollar amount or what percentage. We're a long way from that. And I don't think the nexus has been established completely either. And is there a nexus to other things that lead to the housing affordability problem? You know, we haven't studied that either. I think we need to really truly look at what's the root cause of the problem. I don't think you can stand here, sit here today and say it's new housing that's being built that's the problem, that's the cause of housing affordability. That goes completely against the supply-demand equation. So I would say no.
If I may add, we certainly concur, the city concurs that it's a multifaceted problem requiring creative thought all around the table. One of the things that the city has implemented for housing production, affordable housing production, is to provide developers with very significant reductions in a number of fees that are assessed on housing projects. The residential impact fee, which is basically to pay for parks and recreation, also permitting fees and the planning and development fees as well. So we recognize that that is a critical part of the equation.
It seems that it's like a spider web a bit, and if you touch one place of the web, it has impact someplace else, and so the answers are not going to be simple. Nexus fee, controversial. Inclusionary zoning's been brought up. Inclusionary zoning's another intervention which has some history of controversy in our Southern California community. But at the same time, Jim, I've heard your colleague, Bill Wong, say that City of Pasadena has created far more housing with your inclusionary fee or system than we would ever be able to do with the subsidy dollars available. So let me ask the panel, inclusionary, what's your thought on that? And also understanding that it needs a Sacramento fix, as we've heard earlier, your thoughts? I guess we'll soon be opening it up to the audience for participation as well.
So Tim and I will just banter back. Which is, I look to places like Pasadena and Santa Monica that have very strong inclusionary housing policy, and they do two good things really well. One, the programs really do incentivize developers to build the affordable units on site, which I think is of great value because you get them dispersed throughout the cities. But secondly, when that is not economically feasible, they deliver in lieu fees that help for the production of affordable housing elsewhere in the city. So I think those are two great things. And I think as Jim's numbers reflected, having an inclusionary policy in a city like Pasadena has not deferred the production of market rate housing. So where it works and can achieve both the production of inclusionary housing with market rate as well as production of affordable housing, I think it's a good policy.
Well, I don't really want to repeat my previous comments because I think they all apply here. Again, it comes down to if we do this inclusionary zoning, there have been places that do inclusionary zoning, and we keep talking about the same problem over and over again. It's not solving the problem, right? It doesn't solve the problem. So what we need to do is put together a plan that's actually going to lead to solving the problem, right? Not just point at one small part of it, go after new development to pay for that small part of it, and take, you can take some credit about, well, we provided a certain amount of units when we did that, but I still will say that it doesn't solve the problem. So I think we need to stay focused on the bigger picture of how do we actually go about solving the problem. Is that potentially one piece of it? It may be. But we need to make sure that we put a big picture plan together that we are confident that's going to do that. I commend City of Pasadena for putting other incentives in the process that will bring down the cost to developers, that will add some more value to their project, and it's creative thinking like that, that maybe there are some solutions in there among the other things that we've talked about, maybe it's a combination of all of them, that will lead us to solving that problem. But just inclusionary zoning in and of itself is not the answer.
And yet, I want to jump in for a sec for Tim's. Give you a little bit of support here, Tim, on what you're talking about, a comprehensive solution, because you referred in your opening remarks to a couple of the biggest cost drivers for the construction of affordable housing, low-income housing tax credit projects in particular, I think were the subject of the study, as being scale and community opposition and the number of neighborhood meetings. And I think that building more is a good thing. The size of the affordable housing developments that are being built in Los Angeles County, as well as the city today, are tiny compared to very healthy developments that were built throughout the 60s and 70s in elderly housing and family housing developments. And there are quirks in state subsidy programs that encourage smaller projects, like the larger your percentage of public funding, the higher your tiebreaker score. Well, in a perverse way, that incents smaller projects, particularly when there's a shrinking amount of public funds that are available. And on the community opposition neighborhood meeting size, what stands out to me is the